حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماءه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون. والحمد لله على رسول المسدد المحمود الأحمد أبي القاسم محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه تبارك وتعالى في كتاب المجيد والفرقان الحميد وقوله الحق: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله يحب المحسنين. صلوات على محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. We are gathered here to celebrate the birth anniversary of our 10th Imam, Imam Ali un-Naqi al-Hadi alayhi salam. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. On behalf of all of those present here and elsewhere, and myself, I'd like to extend our heartiest congratulations and tabrikats to our 12th Imam, Imam Sahib Zaman, Ajalallahu Farajahu Sharif, on the birth of day of his grandfather. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The role of any Imam is to ensure that they teach us lessons whereby we can get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After all, what have we been brought on this earth for but to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That is the sole purpose of our existence on this earth. And the idea of ibadah encompasses more than just salat. Very simply, ibadah means anything and everything that you do for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the role of every imam has been to ensure that we get close to our Creator, so that on the day of judgment, when we stand before Him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then at least we can say, we did the best we could on the basis of what you blessed us with. And we hope and pray that the ayat of the Quran would be applicable to us also. Ya ayyatuha nafsul mutma'inna, irji'i ila rabbiki radiyatan mardiyya. O tranquil soul, return to your Lord, pleased with Him, and He pleased with you. To be pleased with somebody is easy. To be pleased with Allah is easy. Of course, all the blessings that we have are there. But for Allah to be pleased with us, that is the grand achievement. And we'll talk about that a little later. When we live in society and we look at a person, when we meet up somebody, we say we like him, or we don't like him. What is it that, when you look at the person, is it his looks that you like? That is very fickle. It will last only for a few seconds. After that, it's over it. But there is something that that person has: how he talks, how he walks, how he speaks, how he acts, what sort of akhlaq that he has, how he makes you feel in his presence is what attracts you to that person. And that is very important, and that is how we operate in society. So today, for the next few minutes that I have with you, I would like to discuss with you and share with you some thoughts as to how Allah, what is it that Allah likes? After all, our responsibility on this earth is to get as close as possible to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, what is it that He likes and what is it that He dislikes? So that we can understand, and hopefully we learn something from it and we can become better for it and we can get closer to Him. Just a few ayats, there is plenty more. The Quran is full of it. By the way, if ever you need to find something and you remember and you are researching and you want that, go to islamicity.org/Quran. And even if you remember, it's called phonetic search. And there where you remember half an ayat, for example, Inna Allaha, for example, and that you can't remember the rest of the ayat, just type down in English, Inna Allaha. And all the ayats that are there with Inna Allaha will all show up. And it will open your mind to something else, and it will open your mind to something else, and more as you go on. The Quran is a deep ocean, as we all know. So what does Allah say? إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ Surah Baqarah, Surah number 2, Ayat 195. Indeed, Allah loves the virtuous ones. What is this muhsinin? Who is a muhsin? One who does ihsan, right? A muhsin is one who does ihsan, one who acts well, does good deeds, and spends in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, when you do something and you get a reward for it, so you do certain amount of good deeds and you get an equivalent reward for it, whatever that reward is, then that is adala. This is what you did, this is what you got. This is it. It was there, established. This is adala. However, when you do this much and you get more than what you deserve, then that is ihsan. Right? This is what ihsan is all about. The other aspect of it, the word ihsan is used. Also, you can say fadl, fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That when you do something good and Allah loves that act, then from His fadl, from His grace, because you have pleased Him, He gives you more than you expect. Look at it in our circumstances. When we are employed or when we employ, if my boss gives me a raise without me asking, if my boss gives me a raise without me asking, then I will consider that he has done ihsan on me, he has done a favor on me. But if I go and ask him and he gives me a raise, then I consider that my right. It could be the same dollar amount. It could be exactly the same dollar amount. When I asked him and I got what I expected, then that is my right. That is the adala that was due for me. But when I got more, when I got it before I asked it, that is ihsan. Right? So in other words, Allah says He loves those who are muhsinin, those who do ihsan. That means they are ones who give beyond what is required. So if you are helping out somebody and that person needs $100 and you give him $200, you have done ihsan up there, right? This is what is the, so Allah says He loves those who do ihsan, who are muhsinin. Then He goes on in another ayat, surah number 2, again surah al-Baqarah, surah 2, ayat 222. Inna Allaha yuhibbu at-tawwabin wa yuhibbu al-mutatahhirin. Allah loves those who seek forgiveness, and He loves those who keep clean, who are in a state of tahara. Very, very important, these two aspects of it. He loves those who do tawbah. When would you do tawbah? When you have erred, when you have made a mistake. And we do that on an ongoing basis. Allah loves to hear our voices. He loves us to come back to Him and acknowledge that He is the one that forgives. That's why He says in so many places, and you know enough about tawbah, whereby Allah says, come, come to me up to the last moment. I am there. You have heard this story many times before, whereby there was a person who used to worship the idols. And all night he would worship an idol during the time of the Bani, prophets of the Bani Israel. And he used to sit in the temple there, and there was an idol before him, and he started worshiping him, and ya sanam, right? He would do that all night. One night, in the middle of the night, he was dozing off, and instead of saying ya sanam, he said ya samad. And a reply from the heavens came, labbaik abdi labbaik. So when the news got to the prophet of the time as to what had happened, so he prayed in his munajat with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He prays to Him and says, Ya Allah, this man does not know You. He does not recognize You. He did not even call You. He called You in error. When he said, Ya Samad, he called You in error. In that, even when he was half asleep, why did You reply? Allah replies to the prophet, says, O my prophet, if I did not reply to him, even in that state, what is the difference between me and that idol? What is the difference between me and that idol? That is why I reply. Allah is there for us at all times. Allah does not need an appointment. Allah does not say that only come at namaz time and masjid time, no. Allah says, talk to me 24/7, 365 and a quarter days, anywhere you are, in the car, in your bed, in the bathroom, in the shower, wherever you are, talk to me, try out, talk to me, remember me, do tawbah to me, I will forgive. After all, who is there to forgive you if I do not forgive you? So come to me, talk to me, Allah loves. And sometimes the ulama tell us that when Allah does not hear, sometimes we complain, Allah does not hear. Allah is not deaf, by the way, He hears. And He, as Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam says, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. In one of his duas, he says that, you know, you are one whom many voices do not confuse. If four of you surround me just now and all four of you start talking at the same time, I will say, hang on a second, can I hear you out, then you, then you, then you, right? Here there is 7 billion people in this world. If all of them talk at the same time and talk to Allah, Allah does not get confused. Huh? He can hear every voice individually and He can answer every voice individually. So Allah says He loves those who do tawbah, who come to Him, who return to Him. وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَهِّرِينَ, and He loves those who keep clean. On an ongoing basis, the taharat that is important that we have, we stay away from najasat, obviously, but we have to try and do that. And when we look around in the masajids, we need to encourage our children, especially in the washrooms and so, to keep that semblance of taharat also. Not only ourselves, but the places of masaj, of sanctity that we have, also need to be kept in a state of taharat at all times. Then Allah goes on and says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Whoever, Allah indeed loves those who are aware of Him. The idea of taqwa. What is taqwa? Again, very simply, being aware of Allah at all times. Being aware of Allah at all times, that you are aware that my Allah is watching me. Not that He is sitting with a big stick and waits for me to make an error so that He can hit me. No, that is not the purpose. But Allah is aware of all I do. Allah is aware of all I do. So when I am aware of Him, then I will be careful about what I do. Then I will be on the path of taqwa. And Allah says He loves those who are yuhibbul muttaqin. Allah yuhibbul muttaqin, those who are aware of Him at all times. Then He goes on and says, Wallahu yuhibbu sabirin. And Allah loves those who are patient. What is this patience that we keep on talking about? Or إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah is with those who are patient. Here Allah says, وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الصَّابِرِينَ, and He loves the steadfast. Imam Ali alayhi salam, quoting from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اللهم صلي على محمد وآل محمد, states that there are three levels of sabr. There are three levels of sabr that we need to be aware of. One is sabr عند المصيبة. Sabr عند المصيبة. When difficulties come our way, when we have, there is a loss of life, there is a loss of fruits, there is a loss of wealth, there is a loss of life, right? When we suffer a calamity, those are the times, right? The famous ayah that you all know. This one, basically, this is the time when we have difficulty. So we bear with patience and we say, Ya Allah, give me the strength to bear this with patience. For indeed, You are the one that loves those who are patient. So sabr عند المصيبة, when difficulties come, sabr at the time of difficulties, whatever that they may be. The next one, which is a higher stage, is sabr على الطاعة. That is sabr in regard to obedience. That means that I am required to pray. Therefore I pray. I make sure that I pray on the right time. I am required to fast. Therefore I fast when the time of my Ramadan is here. I am required to go for Hajj if I am able once in a lifetime. I make a point of doing that. I am required to give khums and zakat and whatever other wajibats that I'm supposed to do, I do them because that is what is required of me. This is the sabr. Sometimes it is difficult. Sometimes it is difficult. Of course it is difficult, right? And especially when it might be a very cold night and you have to wake up early in the morning, 3 o'clock at night, for example, for Fajr prayers. But you wake up, the sabr that you extend said, no, this is what is required of me, therefore I will do it. So you bear it with patience and you do that. So this is a higher stage of sabr. And the third stage, which is even higher, is sabr anil ma'asiyah. That is sabr in regard to disobedience. Right? The first one is the one whereby when difficulties come your way. Second one is when you do what you are supposed to do. And the third one, which is the highest level, is when you stay away from the ill that is you are supposed to stay away from. Sabr anil ma'asiyah. When the doors of haram are open to me, I do not walk through it. Somebody comes to Imam Jaffer al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And he says, Mawla, when I look around and I see the companions that you have who are my friends and your companions, and I compare myself to them, I look at them and I say, Mawla, I have no chance. They have more good than I have. They pray more, they fast more, they give sadaqah more, they do all good deeds more than I do them. Mawla, what chances do I have? Imam tells him and says, you are right. They have more. No doubt about that. However, the difference, do not despair, for the difference between you and them is that whilst they have more, when the doors of ma'asiyah, when the doors of haram are open to them, they just walk right through it. So that the credit balance is very high, but the debit is simultaneously very high. As compared to you, your credit is very low, but your debit is, you stop, you do not enter the door of ma'asiyah as they do, and therefore you keep. Who is a rich person? If I ask this question, you ask this question, who is a rich person? A person who earns $1 million or a person who earns $50,000? Ask you that question, right? Chances are 99% will say the guy who is $1 million, he is rich. But how do you define rich? If the guy who earns $1 million spends $1,000,001, then he's poor. As compared to one who earns 50 and spends 30 and saves 20, who is rich? In monetary terms, who is rich? And for the rest of us, we do not have to despair. For somebody comes to Imam Jaffer al-Sadiq alayhi salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, and says, Mawla, I'm poor. Imam says, don't say you are poor. He says, Mawla, but I'm poor. He says, don't say you are poor. He repeats, Mawla, but I'm poor. He says, Imam says, don't you understand? I'm telling you, don't say you are poor. Let me ask you a question. If the richest man in this world comes and offers you all the wealth that he has in exchange for your iman, would you give it to him? If the richest man in the world comes to you and gives you all the wealth that he owns in exchange for your iman, your belief, your trust in Allah, would you do it? He says, absolutely not, Mawla. The Imam says, then who is rich? You or him? Say, I'm in need. Don't say, I'm poor. For as long as you have iman, you are rich. Yeah. As long as you have iman, you are rich. Don't lose your iman for anything. This is what it is all about. As long as I have iman, I trust Allah. What is it? Today I feel I'm 25 years old and all the wealth that I want to acquire. By the time you reach my age, all this is meaningless. Right? All this becomes meaningless. It does not have the same value that it did 25 years ago. So it changes. But iman, it grows. It grows. And it brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we will see in a few minutes, inshallah. So sabr inda al-musibah, sabr ala ta'a, and the highest level, sabr anil ma'asiyah. If you can't do a lot of good, you are not one who can spend a lot of time in ibadah, or fasting, or waking for namaz al-shab, make sure you don't do evil. Stay away from debt. As long as the debit, the credit is high, is low, make sure the debit is even lower. We are accountants, we are business people, right? We all want to see debits and credits all the time, right? So keep the debit, make sure that the credit is always higher than the debit. Pretty straightforward up there. Then Allah says, "Inna Allaha yuhibbul mutawakkilin." Indeed, Allah loves those who trust in Him. Tawakkul. Trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am going out to work. I am doing the best, putting the best foot forward. I do the best. Do the best that you possibly can and leave the outcome to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, trust me. That is why the young people are told, and marry amongst those who are young, right? وَأَنْكِهُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ إِنْ يَكُونُوا فُقَرَاءَ يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ وَاللَّهُ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Right? That marry amongst those who are young, that if they do that, Allah will give to them from His fadl. But when you tell our young people get married, they say, when I become rich. Oh yeah? When you become rich. When is rich? When do you become rich? Is Bill Gates stopped because he's got $56 billion? Does he stop working and says, I'm rich now, no more? No, he keeps on going. But that's just a sidetrack for a second here. So Allah loves those who trust in Him. Do the best you can. Put the best foot forward. Do all the research that you possibly can within your limitations that you have. And then trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And see what will happen. And then Allah says, "Inna Allaha yuhibbul muqsitin." Indeed, Allah loves the one who are just and equitable. That when you do justice, make sure that you do justice, even though that justice may come against you. Very important that we do that. And we can take it in very small levels. You go to the store, a grocery store, when you buy things, and when you get this long bill that comes along, and you look at it, and you look around, and you say, okay, these prices are good. Oh no, the tomatoes were $2, and they charged me $5. Boom, you go straight to customer service, you overcharge me my $3 back, right? We all do that. The question now is, as you went along that list, and you looked around, and you says, oh, the pineapple was $7, they charged me $2. Would you go to the customer service and say, you undercharged me? Justice is both ways. Eh? Justice has to be both ways. That is something that we really need to ask ourselves. These are trivial things we think, what is it? But no, this is very important. All these small things are extremely important. One day the Prophet ﷺ was going with his ashab outside Medina. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And they camped somewhere in the desert at night. And the Prophet says, go and collect firewood. Because in the desert it gets very cold, you need fire, and also to keep the animals away. They said, Ya Rasulullah, there is no trees up here. There is no trees up here, where will we collect firewood? He says, just go, whatever you can collect. Find out, just go it out. So they all went, eventually they all came back. Somebody collected this much of a twig, somebody collected this much, and they eventually they piled up, and it was a huge bonfire-like thing. And the Prophet says, before you light the fire on this one, let me tell you. Remember when I told you to go and collect this? You said, no, there is no firewood up here. Now you managed to get all this together. How did you find all this? The same way, do not consider an ill as a small one that you have done, a ma'asiyah as a small one. Allah will collect all this and make it a big mountain on the day of Qiyamah. And you will say, I did all that? I did all that? No, it can't be. But Allah does not forget. Allah keeps an account of everything. So justice is something that has to be both ways, even though when it goes against you. And Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam says that Allahu salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Indeed, Allah loves every sorrowful heart and loves every grateful servant. One who is always acknowledging that all the blessings that are there are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My ability to talk, my ability to think, my ability to smell, my ability to sleep, to walk, to talk, to smile. All these things are blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you understand and acknowledge that these are blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Shukra Lillah. You will do that. Now, when you are able to acknowledge and understand and say, Shukra Lillah, Alhamdulillah, you need to say, thank you for that, thank you. The ability to recognize is also a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ability to thank Allah is also an ability from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a no-ending circle. When you acknowledge one, you realize that there is even a better acknowledgement you have to do. And there is a third one. One of the prophets of Allah says, Ya Allah, how do I thank you? For every time I thank you, I have to thank you for thanking you. And Allah says, oh my Prophet, as long as you acknowledge and understand that every ni'mah comes from me, every ni'mah comes from me, you have thanked me enough. So never think I did it. Say, Allah's mercy helped me do it. Allah gave me the tawfiq to do it. Allah gave me that ability to think and do it. Otherwise, who am I? What ability do I have? What can I do? Who am I? I did this. I built this masjid. I did this. Arey Baba, what did you do? Who gave you that brain to think, to deliver, to speak, to think of all these things? It was the ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Acknowledge that. Yes, the efforts are you, but you are, shall we say, become the paintbrush. And leave the painter as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and let him see what he paints. Let him paint and see what you are. Then Allah, these are the things that Allah likes. What does Allah not like? Inna Allah la yuhibbul mu'tadeen. Allah does not like the aggressors. Those who pick up a fight at any instant, any excuse, real or imagined. I must be in the forefront for all fasad. No, Allah does not like aggressors. Inna Allah la yuhibbul mufsideen. Allah does not like the mischief makers. The one who like to pour oil on fire. The one who like to beat the drums. The one who like to send messages out on emails without even understanding what the story is all about. Right? This is our bala these days, right? We don't think. You know, in the old days we used to write a letter. Then we would put that letter away. Thinking that let's see tomorrow and what happens. Today I just write a letter and then I press that send button and Ya Khuda, Inna Lillah wa Inna Ilayhi Raji'un, right? It goes around the world. Before you know, it has come back 10 times over back to you. It has gone around the world. Right? Allah does not like those who are mischief makers. Inna Allah la yuhibbul musrifeen. Allah does not like those who are extravagant and wasteful. Look around what we do. Again, when we talk about israf, israf is relative. Israf is relative. We cannot say, this is israf for you and this is not israf for me. It is relative. But everything in moderation. Islam is a religion of moderation. Never on extremes. Not this extreme, not that extreme. Always the middle course, moderation that we want to go. Do not do israf. And then finally, inna Allah la yuhibbul mustakbirin. Allah does not like the arrogant ones. After all, what do we have? I'm rich. What is that? $56 billion? Or like Carlos Sims, $75 billion? That's all? Beyond that, what? Allah says, أَنَا الْغَنِي وَأَنْتُمُ الْفُقَرَىٰ. I am rich. You are poor. What is it you have? Today, I can eat at lunch 2 chapatis and maybe some rice and maybe some food, okay, and a glass of water or so. Tomorrow I earn $1 million. Maybe my diet will change slightly, but will I be able to eat a gold chapati? No. It won't make any difference whatsoever. Be the same food. And if I earn 2, and if I earn 10, and if I earn 50, it's the same. What is it that I have? So Allah says He does not love the arrogant ones. This is something that we really need to be aware of. In Hadith al-Qudsi, Allah says, O children of Adam, I created everything for you, but I created you for me. I created everything in this world for you, O children of Adam, but I created you for me. That means we are there for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we need to get close to Him as far as possible. So I put this final example in a sport terminology, because our children maybe understand this better. When we live in this world, what is our expectations? That inshallah we will go to Jannah, right? If Jannah is my objective, if that's where I want to end it, then I have sold myself short. I shortchanged myself, if that's Jannah is all I want. Because as I have a belief, and don't ask me for hadith or anything, this is my belief, that as mu'mineen, we will all end up in Jannah. Inshallah. We will all end up in Jannah. Whether we go straight to Jannah or we go through the Jahannam route, we will end up in Jannah. We pray we don't go that route, we go straight in, right? But we will go, inshallah. We will all end up in Jannah. The question is, where in Jannah will we be? All right? Let us look at this example. Imagine that it is the Stanley Cup Finals and that the Maple Leafs are playing. You ain't going to see it in 100 years, forget about it. Yeah. But for those hockey fans, you ain't going to see it in 100 years, but let us assume and entertain us that ourselves with that thought that one day maybe they will get to the semifinal. And they are playing the seventh game, final seventh and final deciding one, now is the best of one, in Maple Leaf Gardens, downtown Toronto. Right? The hype in the city will be through the skies, right? Everybody's there. So you now got into a ticket. You got a ticket. I got a ticket. Everybody else. Everybody that they managed to get a ticket. You paid $50,000 for the ticket right up there. I paid $5 ticket right up at the top on the bleachers. I can't see anything. Eh? I'd like to think I can see everything, but I can see nothing. I need those big TV screens to see. I might as well have watched it at home comfortably and seen that. But anyway, I'm there. You are there. You paid $50,000 for that ticket. I paid $5. We all come out and we all have bragging rights that we were there on the seventh final game in Toronto Maple Leafs and we saw the Maple Leafs win, right? We all have bragging rights. Who is there to check whether I paid $50,000 or who is there to check whether I paid $5? We all claim we were there, right? So yes, we will all be in Jannah, inshallah. But where will you be in Jannah? Close to the Ahlul Bayt, alayhimus salam, at that $50,000 ticket, or right up on the bleachers where you can't see nothing? That is the question. That is the question that we really need to ask ourselves. Maybe I'm happy that as long as I get in there, it doesn't really matter. But no. The point is, you want to aim high. Don't settle for low. Why do you want to settle for low? You want to get as close as possible. All your life, from the day you open your eyes, you have said, Ya Ali, Ya Muhammad, Ya Fatima, Ya Hassan, Ya Hussein. You have been saying all this. And now at that last moment, all your life you did that, you are not able to be close to them. That is a total loss. That would be a total loss, in my opinion. What does Allah say? Allah says in Surah Tawbah, Surah number 9, Ayat 72, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا وَمَسَاكِنَ طَيِّبَةً فِي جَنَّاتِ عَدْنٍ وَرِضْوَانٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ. Allah has promised to believers, men and women, gardens under which rivers flow, to dwell therein, and beautiful mansions in gardens of everlasting bliss. We will all get that. This is a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the greatest bliss is the good pleasure of Allah. This is the grand achievement. I am pleased with Allah, but is my Allah pleased with me? That is the question. He will reward me and give me the Jannah because that is what I deserve. That is His adala. He would do that. But His fadl is what I am requiring. His ahsan is what I am requiring. I want to be pleased. If He is pleased with me, what difference does it make the world is not pleased with me? If Allah is pleased with me, that is where we really need to aim at. That is the ultimate aim that we are trying to aspire for. And will it be easy? Of course not. It will require a lot of struggle, a constant battle against your nafs, against this movement that I am getting close to. This is what my Allah expects from me, and the world can say whatever it wants. I am heading that on that path, and nothing is going to shake me up there. Then and then this ayat of the Quran will be applicable to me. Ya ayyatuha an-nafsul mutma'inna irji'i ila rabbiki radiyatan mardiyya. Oh, tranquil soul, return to your Lord, pleased with Him, and He pleased with you. That is what it's all about. If we can get to that level, then we are successful. Then this life has been worth it. Otherwise, may Allah help us. That is all we can ask for. On this auspicious day of the birth of our Imam, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ilahi bihaqi Muhammadin wa anta al-Mahmud. Ilahi bihaqi Aliyin wa anta al-A'la. Ilahi bihaqi Fatima wa anta fatir al-samawati wal-ard. Ilahi bihaqi al-Hasani wa anta al-Muhsin. Ilahi bihaqi al-Husayn wa anta qadimu al-Ahsan. Ilahi bihaqi tis'atil ma'asumina min dhurriyati al-Hasani wal-Husayn alayhimus salam. O Allah, accept this ibadat of ours. Give us the tawfiq to remain on the right path, the path of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. O Allah, we are indeed pleased with you for all the blessings that you have bestowed upon us. But give us the tawfiq to be what you expect us to be so that you can be pleased with us. Because that is the grand achievement. Ya Allah, those that are sick, grant them shifa. Those that are distressed in whatever the part of the world that they may be in, grant them quick relief from their distresses. Ya Allah, those that are in difficulties, lessen their difficulties in the name of our Imam, in whose birthday we are celebrating. Ya Allah, those that may have difficulties with jobs or employment or loans or whatever it might be, lessen their difficulties and grant them from your ghaib, inshallah. May Allah hasten the appearance of our Imam and give us the tawfiq to be of assistance to him. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, Thabbit qalbi ala deenik. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, ثبت قلبي على دينك يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلبي على دينك رحم الله من قرأ سورة المباركة الفاتحة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أفضل السلام محمد وآل محمد
بر محمد وآل محمد صلوات ہمت ہی کس میں در خیبر کو کھاڑے ہمت ہی کس میں در خیبر کو کھاڑے انتر کو کرے زیر او مرحب کو پچھاڑے گہوار میں لیٹے ہوئے اجدر کو بھی پھاڑے ڈوبے ہوئے سورج کو جو مغرب سے اُبھارے یہ کون عجائب کا مظہر کون ولی ہے یہ مولا علی مولا علی مولا علی ہے یہ مولا علی ہے یہ مولا علی کعبے میں مولود کے سی پی میں گوہر ہے یہ نور کی بارش ہے کہ حوروں کا سفر ہے دیوار بنی در یہ تو حیدر کا سر ہے مکہ کی فضاؤں میں بھی پھیلی یہ خبر ہے کس نور سے ملنے کو چلا نور نبی ہے یہ مولا علی مولا علی مولا علی ہے یہ مولا علی ہے یہ مولا علی اونٹوں کی قطاروں کو جو خیرات کیا ہو سے روزوں کی جو نان جمی بخش دیا ہو سائل کو رکوع میں انگوٹھی جو دیا ہو شب روز یتیموں میں غذا صرف کیا ہو ارے حاتم ہے کجا یہ تو سخی ابن سخی ہے یہ مولا علی مولا علی مولا علی ہے یہ مولا علی ہے یہ مولا علی ہے ہجرت کی رات جان محمد پہ بنی ہے ہجرت کی رات جان محمد پہ بنی ہے ایک جان ہے خطرے میں تو ایک جان بچی ہے بستر پہ ہے کوئی کوئی ہمراہ نبی ہے دشمن یہ سمجھتے ہیں کہ چادر میں نبی ہے یہ کون ہے بستر پہ جو ہم شکل نبی ہے یہ مولا علی مولا علی مولا علی ہے یہ مولا علی ہے یہ مولا علی ہے صلوات اللہ
الہی بیمار دشت بلا جو بیمار ہو جلد پاوے شفا الہی برائے امام زمان شرس قیامات کے مشہور ہوگا علی ٹھیک ہے سے کہ